Welcome back to Good Morning Tasland. As you may have heard this morning, the Prime Minister has just announced a bipartisan committee to investigate potential policy responses to climate change.
Though many groups have welcomed this move, the announcement contained very little detail on exactly what type of policy responses the government will be investigating. This uncertainty has industry concerned, as many companies in Tasland try to anticipate what the impact might be on their businesses.
We've brought in international climate law expert Dr Justine Bell-James to shed some light on the subject. Dr Bell-James was a delegate at the United Nations 2015 Climate Change Summit in Paris. Thanks for coming in to speak with us, Doctor. Now, can you tell us about what our government's policy approaches might look like?
Thank you. I'm happy to be here. Well, really, there are four broad approaches that the government would be considering. The easiest response is to adopt a wait-and-see approach. This option puts a focus on adaptation, because doing nothing to reduce our carbon emissions now means greater costs in the future from all kinds of potential disasters. The alternative is to start reducing greenhouse gas emissions now to reduce damages in the future, and we call this mitigation. To do this, we essentially have three main options. We could take a regulatory approach, or introduce a price on carbon, or use direct climate financing.
There is a lot to unpack there. So let's talk about the regulatory approach. Would that mean that the government makes it illegal to emit greenhouse gases?
Not entirely illegal. Under direct regulation, or the so-called command and control approach, the government would set laws requiring emissions to be reduced, but not stopped. This could include fuel efficiency standards in cars, for instance.
That sounds like it could be expensive. What about the direct climate finance policy option? How does that work?
In that case, government would offer funded incentives such as grants and subsidies to encourage the development and uptake of low emission technologies like solar panels or improve public transport options.
So you've got the punishment option and the reward option. What's the third and final one? The carbon pricing, as you called it.
Right. Well, carbon pricing is a bit of both. Rewarding companies for low emissions and costing them if they don't reduce emissions. There are two types of carbon pricing mechanisms that government could consider. So first, it could put in place a carbon tax. This is essentially a fixed price payable for every tonne of carbon dioxide and other greenhouse gases emitted by a large facility or organisation. Quite a simple approach, but not guaranteed to meet Tasland's reduction target. Alternatively, the government could introduce a market-based emissions trading scheme. This approach is technically harder to implement, but politically more desirable, as government just sets the rules of the game and then leaves industry to find the most cost-effective pathway to reduce emissions.
So with so many options in the climate policy toolbox, how do governments choose which policies to implement?
Yeah, it's a challenge. Adaptation, command and control, direct climate financing and carbon pricing, all of these policy approaches have advantages and limitations, and they all have impacts on business and the economy. Some criteria that governments need to consider are, firstly, which policy or combination of policies will allow the country to meet its emissions reduction target? And secondly, how will these policies support the economy to adapt to the inevitable climate change impacts and an increasingly carbon-constrained world? And finally, what will be the most cost-efficient way of achieving these results?
Dr. Bell-James, this has been a very enlightening conversation. Thank you so much for your time today.
Thank you for having me.
We'll be back after this.